And by the way, this is going to be, we are live on Facebook during the breaks as well. So.
Oh, okay. Watch my language.
Yeah. All right. Mike's going off.
Okay.
Warning, you are about to listen to the greatest radio show ever. And due to contractual obligations and to shield our airwaves and corporate licensees from any semblance of liability, responsibility, and gullibility, we must tell you the views represented on this show are not necessarily those of this station or its management. This radio show contains differing points of view on current political topics, and due to the nature of its contents, it should be heard by everyone. Thank you for listening. 3, 2, 1. Now live from the Devil Radio Studios in Madison, Wisconsin, where the political party is just beginning. Welcome to the Devil's Advocate Show. Friends proving it's never personal, only politics.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
Here is your host, Mike Crute.
Good afternoon, everybody. If I sound different, it's because I'm not Mike Crute. I am Pete Schwaba, filling in for Dom and Crute, giving them a little well-deserved break on this Friday afternoon, sort of a summer afternoon, technically fall, but we don't have to acknowledge that just yet. It's a beautiful day outside, but I am in for Dom and Crute today. They will be back on Monday, and like I said, earning some well-deserved time off. We're going to do a little bit of a shift today, too. My background is in show business. I'm not a devil. I'm not even an advocate for anything. I advocate nothing, which should put everyone at ease and encourage you to join in the show at some point today. We're going to be talking entertainment today, for the most part. We're going to be talking movies, TV, streaming. See, my goal here today, folks, is I know you don't know me very well. I want you to stay with me. I want you to listen. I want you to contribute, and by the end of this show, I'm hoping you all will have something you can watch tonight or this weekend. I want you to leave here with some great ideas for movies, TV, and I'd like to hear what you're watching too. I'm always looking for something. My biggest thing is I cannot stand scrolling for something to watch. You log into Roku or your smart TV. You check Hulu, you check Netflix, you check HBO, Apple TV. You spend an hour looking for something to watch. It's ridiculous. So I would like to just jump in and let's help each other out here. Let's have a nice exchange of what we're watching and we can all walk away with something here that we can look forward to. So like I said, my name is Pete Schwaba. I will also have some outstanding guests today. First of all, Nate Wagehout is the producer today. Nate, say hello.
Hello, hello. How are we doing today, Pete?
We're doing great. You and I both have, I will say, when I met you, Nate, your last name, Wagehout, loved it. Because I think I told you that makes Schwaba sound like Smith. Because people have always messed up my name, but I can't even imagine the trauma you've been through in your life with that last name.
I have heard every single variation that you can think of for my last name. And in fact, you say trauma. I had a middle school basketball coach. You know what he would call me? This is the coach. You call me Wedgie. Call me, hey, Wedgie, come here. So, you know what? You know what? You can call me whatever you want. Just please don't call me Wedgie anymore.
You are I got enough of that
in middle school.
That's horrible. That's just encouraging kids to go there, you know? Or even an atomic wedge. You don't need that. That's I'm glad that's in your past. Put that in the rearview, Nate, because you're
Thank
safe.
Thank you, Pete.
We have some great guests today. I'm going to welcome Mike Clemens will be up in just a few minutes to talk some Packers. I consider personally sports to be entertainment. I don't know about you guys. It's all showbiz to me. So we're going to talk a little sports with Mike and we'll talk Packers. Mike's got the inside scoop. He is our Packers reporter. After Mike, we are going to welcome a gentleman who I have written with and sold some movies with. His name is Greg Glienna. He will be joining us. Greg started the Meet the Parents franchise. He shot a little indie film. It's up on YouTube now. We'll tell you how to get there. He's a great interview. He'll be here at 4, a little bit after the bottom of the hour. Rob Thomas from the CapTimes. He's the features editor. He's going to join us in the second hour. And we'll have a special guest too, to promote some live theater from the area. It's going to be a great show and we're going to talk movies. Like I said, summer is, I guess, officially over, but if you want to call in, tell us what you watched this summer. I want to hear what you saw at the theater. I want to hear what you streamed. We can have an open conversation here. Did you watch Barbenheimer? Did you see either one of those two? I'll share with you guys what I saw and, give a brief synopsis, but, I want to hear what you guys are watching. So always feel free to call. Nate, can we give the number out? Can we share the number? Do they know the number?
Yes, of course. It's 844-967-2789. Give us a call. I'll be over here. I'll be lightly screening your calls as you come in. But if you have anything you want to say about movies today, doing things a little bit different on the Devils while the regular Devils are out in the way. So
I am not
that's
a devil.
844-967-2789.
If you're driving, folks, I'm sorry about that phone number. We need a better phone number. That's the phone number they give you when they want people to forget your phone number. But hopefully people have it memorized right now because they listen to Dom and Cruz. So that's good. I want to reiterate, I am not a devil. I am not an advocate. I do not, I'm not filling anybody's shoes here. Those are four huge shoes to fill. So we're just kind of holding down the fort here. So, and here's another thing, Nate, what I want to do is people, since they're used to politics, in this couple hour slot here, we can have, if you want to call in and tell us your favorite political movies, we can do that too. My personal favorite is, I'm blanking. I love A Few Good Men. I don't know if you call that a political movie.
I would consider it a political movie.
It's kind of political. All the President's Men. Love it. Mm-hmm. I just watched it about 6 weeks ago. I don't know what it is about summer that makes me want to watch that movie, but I love the meeting in parking garages and the source you can't reveal and all the threat. It's kind of a thriller too. I love that genre. So do you have a favorite political movie, Nate?
I do. And again, I think it's sort of like yours. I would call it a political movie. It's The Parallax View. It's with Warren totally Beatty, political. Back from the 70s, a lot of intrigue, a lot of, journalistic investigation into shady back government deals and things like that.
Yeah.
It feels very 70s because it's all about political assassinations and things like that, which a lot of that, I mean, that part, I suppose, doesn't really ring true today. We don't, thankfully, don't have a lot of political assassinations anymore, but you know, that was coming off of, both the Kennedys there.
Luther King.
Yeah. So but it holds up very well in my
That's
opinion.
That's good to know. I haven't seen that in about 30 years. It had kind of a creepy element too. The thriller part was really brought out in that. I remember as a kid seeing that and just being like, oh my gosh, I'm scared to death. You know,
there's that one scene. I think it's sort of in like the beginning of the final third of the movie where like they're showing like the video, sort of brainwashing thing of the main character Warren Beatty is sit down in a chair and a screen is put up in front of him and it says love and it has like a bunch of pictures of things that would remind you of love and family, mother, father. Then it gets into war, violence, murder, things like that. Sort of the brainwashing of your mind like that.
Right.
That's one of my favorite scenes.
That's a great scene. It's a great movie. I'll have to revisit that one. Another one politically I like is Election. I know it's a comedy. My background is comedy, so I tend to steer more towards the comedies. But Election is just a phenomenon. It's about a student election. Matthew Broderick is in it. Reese Witherspoon, Chris Klein. Great film. Really funny. Kind of dark, but a very good political movie, too. Even though it's at the high school level, it's a student council election. And Reese Witherspoon is hilarious. So call us, give us a call if you want. Let us know your favorite political movie. It's 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. You can tell us your political movie and party affiliation does not matter. Most of these movies are pretty bipartisan, but tell us your favorite political movie. And if you want to talk a little summer box office, that's fine too. Like I said, we're just on the heels of the summer box office. I'll tell you what I saw. I did see Barbenheimer. I saw Barbie. I saw Oppenheimer. I liked Barbie. I didn't love Barbie. I don't think the movie was as good as the trailer, and that's not that uncommon, but I hate when I see a trailer and it makes me want to run to the theater and then I'm let down. And it's not really a fair fight because the trailer's like 2 minutes long, the movie's 2 hours long, but I did like Barbie. I liked Oppenheimer, kind of the same deal. It was so loud and so long. I went to see it in July. I got out a week ago Tuesday. This thing was like the longest movie ever. But it was good.
You just explained why I haven't seen it yet. I don't want to see a 3-hour plus movie.
You got to carve out so much time. It's insane.
90 minutes. keep it at 90 minutes. Yeah. That's perfect. It's not too
or at least
long.
Under
it's
2 hours.
Too poor.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, it's Christopher Nolan, so I went to see it with my son. I did see Equalizer 3. I loved both the first Equalizers, Denzel Washington, loved it. This one was good. It had a bit of a Roadhouse element to it though, but it was in Italy and it was a beautiful small town, but it was great. So, actually we have a caller. Let's go to, let's see what Andrew from Detroit has to say. How's it going, Andrew?
Pretty good. Good job guys with this show. Not a movie, but a television series is Scandal. I've watched Scandal from beginning to end like 3 times. And wow. I was always amazed with the writing that the subplot or backplot was most of the time more interesting than the episode plot.
That's just a sign of great writing, I think. And I agree, Andrew. I've only seen a couple episodes of that, but it's so well done. Tony Goldwyn's great. Kerry Washington is great. So you're saying you watched the whole series 3 times?
3 times. It's that good. Yeah, wow. I had to go back and catch all the little this and the little that I missed the first and second time through. It's just exciting, just as exciting when you watch it again. It's great.
TV do you watch, Andrew? What
Some
else
of the
do you
best
watch?
I've ever seen.
Sorry, can you repeat? Go ahead.
Some of the best television writing I've ever seen.
That's outstanding. What else are you watching right now, Andrew?
You know, I'm not finding a lot of political movie or television series that give me that kind of excitement. Again, with the writer's strike going on and everything, I'm hoping there are some genius minds out there that when they finally come back, there'll be some great entertainment. They've got it in them, so I'm just waiting for it.
I think it might be time to give Scandal a fourth try there, Andrew. Thanks so much for the call, buddy. Have a great day.
And we do have a couple of texts coming through of some people's favorite political movies or TV shows. We have Madison Plummer saying, Don't Look Up, both funny and terrifying. We have another one that says Babylon 5 is the best political drama. And along that line, I would say Star Trek.
Yeah, Star Trek.
I love Star Trek. It's very political.
Yeah, it is political.
And then finally, Crudy texting in, actually, and he's saying The Sopranos, the Sen Robert Mendez story.
I just rewatched Sopranos. I finished it a week ago.
Can I say something?
He's supposed to be taking the day off, and he's texting us. I love it. Yeah, go ahead.
I've never seen The Sopranos.
Oh, you got to watch it. We'll talk more about it. We've got Mike Clemens coming up next, right?
We do.
All right, so get your movies ready, folks. Summer block, whatever you want to talk about. We're going to play a game called Guess the Scene later, too. So stay with us, folks. Thanks so much. Nate, you there?
Just a heads up, Mike Clemens is on.
Okay, perfect. Catherine said, love to hear your volume up, Pete.
Yeah.
Am I loud enough?
I think you're loud enough.
Maybe she meant something else. Okay. I trust you. I'm just letting you know. Is that another text? Vincenzo on Netflix. We can go back to these, Nate, too, at some point.
Sure. Give me a sec here. I got this song.
Yeah, no rush.
All right, a couple seconds here.
The Devil's Advocates, because freedom.
Welcome back to the show. I'm Pete Schwaba, and for Dom and Crute, the Devils are taking a day off, a well-earned day off. I'm Pete Schwaba with Civic Media here. We are talking movies today. Badger football coming up, too, at 6 o'clock, turning to sports a bit here. We are going to welcome into the show our Packers reporter. You know him and you love him, Mike Clemens. Mike, how are you?
Good, Pete. How are you?
I'm doing great. I'm so glad you could be with us today. There's something about Friday in the fall where all I want to do is talk about football. So it's so great to have you. How are things looking for this weekend? Can you give us a quick preview of the game this weekend?
We had the Packers had their final practice today, and you've been trying to keep an eye on to see if Jordan Love can be at full strength in terms of, you know, the weapons around him. And Christian Watson has not been there yet. He suffered a hamstring injury toward the last week at camp. He's getting closer and closer. Aaron Jones had a big game in the season opener in Chicago against the Bears, and you saw him on a 35-yard touchdown pass go into the end zone there at Soldier Field and suddenly grabbed the back of his behind his knee on his left leg, and he said he tweaked it. He says, I know what a hamstring tear is. This is just a bite. But whatever, you know, he missed the game in Atlanta. They probably could have really used him there. So, you know, they're limited in practice. I thought it was a good question. We just asked LaFleur about an hour and a half ago in his final press conference of the week was, you know, do you play Christian Watson or Aaron Jones on Sunday against the Saints when next Thursday night you're going to be back here at Lambeau Field against a tough divisional opponent in the Detroit Lions? And LaFleur dismissed that. Like, you know what? No, we got to win home games. We got to win whoever we're playing. And if those players are ready to go, we base it on that. We don't do any of this, you know. Well, maybe we should let them rest another four more days when we really need them against the Lions. So, and then he was asked about David Bakhtiari, and he says, you'll have to wait till the game day. Because he's so done with the questions after 2.5 years about David Bakhtiari and his poor left knee that he suffered a torn ACL with. So that's what the update in terms of the injuries.
Okay, so has David Bakhtiari always been this outspoken? He is not afraid to speak up the last few months, whether it's turf or politics or whatever. I never realized he was that outspoken before.
As a matter of fact, when David started in Green Bay like 11 years ago, he was a fourth-round pick out of a losing program in Colorado. And they were doing one-on-ones in training camp, and Clay Matthews could not get around this kid, could not get around him. And about the third rep he did, he was so frustrated, Clay took his helmet and pulled his chin strap on and threw his helmet down in frustration. And David Bakhtiari has started left tackle ever since then. And after about a year or so, you know, because he was such a good player, and you're starting left tackle, an important position on a, you know, the blind side guy on a football team, for some reason, you would go to him, just ask him questions, and his answers would be like, you know, I don't know, what do you think? And that kind of, he was just like playing with you, but it was getting to be a waste of your time. And I thought, I went to the ESPN reporter and said, is that just me? Or he goes, no, is it me? I'm done with him. And we didn't talk to him for about a year, just because it was a waste of time. Until finally he started asking the PR staff, hey, how come these guys won't talk to me anymore? Fast forward, you know, it was a show that I was a part of where I actually booked him, and he was on our show every week, and he turned out to be he's a smart, articulate kid who actually took us aside one day and said, you know what, I'm a little ADD, you know, and it's kind of hard for me to communicate that way. Well, now he's articulate. He's always been a smart kid, fast processor, and he's banked a lot of money from the NFL. So I think he's at a point where he feels that if he's got something to say, he can say it now. And the other thing that I found so interesting, we talked to him for a half hour Wednesday, Pete, about this situation that popped up with him missing the game and the Falcons. And he said, he admitted, you know something? You know why I'm still doing this? Because I'm still doing it better than anybody else. They can line up anybody, outside linebacker, pass rusher against me, and I'm still beating these guys on one leg. And that's what's going on. His technique and his footwork has always been amazing. And so besides making $23 million this year off the salary cap, he is still one of the very best. His technique is down to a martial art, down to a science, and you can't get him. You can't. It's so hard to beat, and he just thinks it's pretty funny he can still pull this off despite the inflammation, the draining of fluids. And frankly, what was most revealing, he's going through a lot of pain with this thing. It's more than just inflammation and swelling. He's in excruciating pain, and that's what he's having to deal with to try and get another year or two in the NFL.
I love that you said he was a fourth-round pick from a bad program. It just goes to show you, even general managers in the NFL, they're all smarter than me or all smarter than you maybe, but like even fantasy football, you're right half the time. You're right about as much as these general managers are sometimes. You never know where a great player is going to come from. So, Mike.
Or what school they're going to come from. What school they're going to come from.
Or too. Even division. Yeah, exactly.
At the end of the day, they're all great athletes, and then you've got to figure out if, in fact, how hard they're going to work once they get their opportunity in the NFL.
That's a great point. Should the Packers be scared of the Lions? They seem like they came out guns blazing, and then all of a sudden, Dan Campbell, people are like, you love his energy, but questionable calls. What do you think?
No. I think the Lions are a very physical team and highly motivated and dangerous. And so far, Dan Campbell is 4-0 against Green Bay.
Yeah. I think he's great for the NFL. You love his energy. I just feel like he at some point, and I have no idea what I'm talking about, but that he'll be his own worst enemy or go for it on 4th-and-14 from his own 2 or something like that. I don't know. And tell us, Mike, what's going on with the Bears? Hell, this hall's a mess right now, isn't it? Are there anyone that NFC, the Packers should be scared of other than the Lions?
Yeah, the defensive coordinator resigns, a qualified NFL guy. There was reports that the FBI was going through Hallis Hall. The NFL Network said, well, that's not necessarily the case. Maybe there was some sort of an internal private investigation going on. And they got Justin Fields questioning his coaching. I'll tell you what, when the Packers beat them and the way they beat them week one, after 30 years of waiting for Favre and Rodgers to move on, it really gutted the emotions of that place. And the wheels have come off in Chicago right now.
Yeah, you can definitely tell. Thanks a lot, Mike. We got to let you go. Thanks so much, as always. Greg Glienna is coming up next, folks. Stay with us. How was that on time, Nate?
Hey, yeah, I'll give him a call right away here.
Now, does this mean 30 seconds when you go like that?
Yeah, this is 30.
Okay, did I get seconds. Out on time?
Oh, yeah, no, we were perfect.
Oh, good, okay.
Any music requests?
Oh, how about some Sinatra? Greg's a big crooner guy. Or Tony Bennett, someone like that?
I can get
not a huge deal, but if you can find it.
Yeah, I can get some Sinatra. Some New York, New York.
Do you have something else besides that song?
Nope. Oh, besides that specific song?
Yeah.
Do you want?
Yeah.
Just like... I've got the world on a string.
That's great.
Or that's life.
World on a string is great. Thank you.
Perfect. Yeah. All right, and I'll give him a call quick. Hey, Pete, I just called Greg and he did not pick up there. So I left him a message, told him to give me a call back, but I'm going to try him again in a
second. I'll send him a text too.
Sure. Yeah, and I left him a message, gave him the number there. And
your 608 area?
Our number is 844-967-2789.
Producer just tried to call you, but you didn't pick up, period. You can call 844-967-2789 or just pick up when he calls you back. Thanks.
I'll do it right after we come back from break. And here we go.
The devil's advocates may not agree on much, but funny is funny.
I've got the world on a string.
Welcome back to the devil's advocate. I am Pete Schwaba, sitting in for Dom and Crute. I'm not a devil, nor am I an advocate. But I am filling in today. They're taking a well-earned break. Hey, if you haven't downloaded the Civic Media app yet, you really should. It's a very easy-to-use app. You can get all of our stations all across the state. Today, we're broadcasting from beautiful WGBW in Green Bay, 97.9 and 1590 AM. But the app has all of our stations, and you can catch the Badger game right after the show tonight at 6 o'clock, preferably on WRJN. Badger football coming up at 6. We have Rob Thomas in the second hour, who's going to be talking movies and also tell us what we should be watching. We are waiting to get a hold of our next guest. He is the creator of Meet the Parents, the franchise, really. He shot an independent film, and it's on YouTube. You can watch it. Same title, and it's outstanding. And he sort of started the whole thing with Meet the Parents, from an indie film, wrote it, directed it, starred in it, and then it went on, sold it to Universal, and it went on to become the highest, I believe, the highest grossing live-action film still there is. And he is my sometime writing partner and very good friend from my stand-up comedy days. So please welcome to the show, Greg Glienna. Greg, how are you?
Hello.
How's it going?
Hey, Pete. Long time. Well, not that long.
Going great. Not that long, but I know you like to sleep in, but you're in Chicago, so I assume you've been up for a while now. Is that correct?
Well, I'm actually staying at my sister's with the dog from hell who barks any time anyone comes within a mile of the house. So
well, we might want to talk to him and find out what he's watching. Greg, thanks for thanks for being with us today. I want to talk about Meet the Parents, but just a little background. Greg and I have known each other forever since our stand-up days in Chicago. He started before me. He's much older than me. But we had a lot of fun writing together. We sold some scripts, only one of which got made, called A Guy Thing. We can talk about that later too. But first I want to ask you, tell us about, you have two other films coming out. Let's talk about, you have The Puppy Love coming out on Freevee, and then another film called The Road Dog, both canine related. Tell us about them, please.
Yeah, it's coincidence. The dog related. But Puppy Love is, it's a cute rom-com. And, some you write for love and some you write for money. That was a money. And it didn't help that three other writers got on it after we sold the original script.
Oh, really?
So that's the kind of thing that I am hoping to move back into the indie film world, just for that reason, because nobody rewrites it and you get to make the film that you envisioned, you know?
Yeah, that's a great point. Yeah, you know, we used to talk about this all the time. What drove me crazy was they buy a script, you do your two rewrites, they bring in other writers. And in our case with A Guy Thing, they brought in two really solid TV writers who have won Emmys, but you mix, especially in comedy, I think you mix sensibilities and there's just a disconnect there and it doesn't work.
I have a lot to say about that Guy Thing, because Guy Thing was, as you remember, a perfect script. The script that sold was just tight and right out of the gate. It was funny and it had a great ending, and it was a great, great script. And that's probably why it sold and got made. But I was embarrassed by the film. I remember being at the previews, just cringing at what they did to it.
Right.
And we got kind of an education of how a script gets ruined. Because I don't know if you remember this, but here's how I remember it. The first draft, you know, sold, and they're like, this script is in great shape.
Yeah.
You know, just take a look at this ending. The ending's a little dark, but the script's great. Then we change the ending, you know. Then they go, well, you know, so look at some of the dialogue here in the middle. Maybe you can punch it up a little bit, and maybe this is shame. Then you do that. I think they get sick of it. And they read it too many times, and they bring into it. Then other writers come in and they audition on that. Well, we can make it wacky, like Meet the Parents or like whatever, you know.
Right.
And then the actors come in and they have ideas. I remember Julie Stiles wanted a female writer to add some of her ideas. And, you know, and by the time it comes out, it's a hodgepodge.
Yeah. I remember Julia Stiles told us she wanted her character to work odd jobs. It's like, well, okay. That's, I don't really see how that's pertinent to the story, but, and I love the idea that they said something about Meet the Parents too, Greg, after we were let go. It's like, wait a minute. You just had the guy who created Meet the Parents and you just let us go. So what are you doing? So, hey, talk a little bit about, go ahead.
Gets ruined, you know?
Yeah, no, for sure. There's just too many cooks.
Yeah. Remember David Ladd at one point, he's in the room going, what if instead he's a football player?
Instead of a cop, right.
In our script. do you remember that? It was like, okay, that's a whole different script, but okay, you know.
He wanted that character to be on the Chicago Bears, and he wanted the main character to have to get him to a game. And we're like, wait a minute. Okay. That sounds like a movie, like Get Me to the Greek, you know. But that was crazy. And I love David, but, you know. Yeah. So, hey, Greg, tell us a little bit about the road. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, that's what happens when you sell a script to Hollywood.
Right.
You do what they want to it, you know. Sometimes it works out. Most of the time it doesn't.
Exactly. And I know you and I know we're kind of talking inside here, but I don't mind giving people some insight here. When you sell a script, one time, one producer told us, I don't think writers should direct their own stuff. And especially in comedy, and you and I, probably to our detriment, pointed out to him, tactfully, I thought, that most successful comedies are directed. There's either a writer director or there's a director who works well with a writer and they have a track record. So I agree. You get too many sensibilities.
Right.
But so you have another film. I know you're really proud of this one. The Road Dog. Tell us a little bit about The Road Dog. I understand you have a guy who just has a couple lines who played a comedy club owner who really jumped off the screen.
Right. Right. Well, it stars Pete Schwab. I don't know if you've heard of him. No, it's a script that I love, and we were able to make the movie that we wrote, you know what I mean? And budget-wise, we had to cut some stuff that we couldn't afford to do, but I would rather, and I've said this to you many times, I would rather make small films that I'm really proud of than sell a script to Hollywood and have it ruined.
Yeah. No,
as long as I can make a living, you know, hopefully, but I mean, I would rather have work and I look back on my career and the stuff that I had total control over. I know this probably sounds conceited, but it's the absolute truth, is the stuff that turned out well, you know, my Meet the Parents, the play that I did in LA that, you know, and some of these short films but whenever I don't have the say I'm embarrassed by it.
Right, because when it's one vision, it at least works. You might not love the film but it's a consistency, I guess. Tell us a little bit, the audience, a little bit about Meet the Parents. It was a great experience for you, yet a frustrating one, and certainly tell us where we can see your Meet the Parents, the much darker, much more indie one, which in my opinion is even funnier than the original. I've gotten crazy looks for saying that, but it is true.
Well, Louis C.K. just said that on a podcast somebody sent me. He was talking about Meet the Parents. He goes, someone sent me a video, Emo Phillips sent me, you know, and he said it was funnier than the remake. But okay, I'll tell the Meet This Parent story in brief. I did a short film. I was doing stand-up comedy at the time, and I did a short film called The Vase, which was about a guy who meets his girlfriend's parents and he breaks their prize vase. And I became friends with Emo Phillips, who was a very well-known comedian at the time. And he happened to have seen this short on a TV show in Chicago called Image Union on PBS. I think it's still on even, where they show short films. And he said he saw it, you know, and he liked this short I did. And I said, well, I have this idea for turning into a feature, you know. And he said, well, why don't you write that? And if I like it, I'll put money into it. So I wrote it with a girl named Mary Ruth Clark, and we just, you know, wrote this script, and he liked it, and he funded it. It was very low budget, and it's, you know, it was Meet the Parents, and I played Greg, and it did very well. It got played at the Music Box Theater in Chicago and got rave reviews, and for a time it was going to be released by National Lampoon, but that ended up falling through because it was too low budget. We did it for $30,000 initially.
Yeah, it's incredible.
It's a lot of money in life, but not in a movie. So basically it got seen by Steven Soderbergh, who called me up and said, you know, I saw your film. This should be a studio film because everyone in the world can relate to this. So he brought it into Universal and he was going to direct, and I sold it. So we had tried to get distribution, and we couldn't, even though we got rave reviews. There wasn't the film festival route there is now. There's so many other places. If I made that today, there'd be a whole bunch of fests we could be in, you know, but
right.
So he brought it into Universal and they remade it, and that would all be great if they would let me show mine, but they still technically own the rights to it, and they will not let me show mine.
I thought yours was on YouTube.
It is on YouTube. It was silenced, but it's on YouTube unannounced. But there are some people who have the link.
I just let the cat out of the bag. Sorry. Go to YouTube fast, folks, if you want to watch Greg's Meet the Parents. Sure.
But it's if you do some digging on the internet, it can be found. I've been told.
Okay. I really encourage I really encourage people to see it. Greg's is, like I said, darker, funnier, very much low budget, but you really feel like you're sucked into the world. I think more like Ben Stiller's great, you know, Robert De Niro's great, but you're always aware you're watching a movie. But some of these indie films, especially your Meet the Parents, you just feel like you're really in that world. It's so much fun to watch.
Yeah, it has more of a reality to it, I think.
Okay, so you Greg, know, so I want to ask.
That's
all. Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say there is a book coming out, which I did not write, but by a very talented Chicago writer named Laura Enright, and it's the Meet the Parents story from the beginning all the way to the, you know, the remake came out. But it's coming out in, I think, December, Bear Manor Press.
Wow!
I was interviewed extensively for it. Yeah.
I'm sure you held your tongue and didn't say anything that was negative.
Oh no, I was. She was very hard on this writer named I won't even say his name. You know who it is.
I know who it is. Yeah.
Who did the rewrite? Yeah, but she caught him in a lie. Actually, he's not going to be happy about this. So.
Well, it's on her though. That's great, and I'm glad that you're getting your side of it out, because that's great. And I want to tell one of the best lines you've ever said, in my opinion. And then I want to ask you what you're watching before we let you go. Greg and I sold a script called Dream Girl to Warner Brothers, but before it sold, we were having trouble getting people to buy it. So there was one scene in the film. Well, the premise is the biggest movie star, let's say Julia Roberts, falls in love with like a guy that manages a Steak and Shake in Ohio. Think like Jack Black. And he helps her change a tire in the middle of the night.
No one sees them together. That's
right. That's the whole joke of the movie, is no one believes him, but she is in love with him and stalking him. So that some studio executives said, we don't think America will be able to relate to being stalked by a famous movie star. To which Greg said, so what? I liked Gladiator, and I never avenged my family in old Rome.
Did I say
that? You did say that. All right, so Greg, this whole, we only have like a minute. Hey, can you stick around for a couple minutes?
Sure.
Okay, I want to ask you the whole, what we're trying to do today, Greg, I'm filling in for Dom and Crute, the Devil's Advocates. The show is usually political, but I'm trying to get people to watch stuff. I want to find out what people are watching. I want to hear what you're watching. So during the break, maybe you could take a couple minutes and just think about what you, a referral you can give people, the audience, like what you, we can stream, or, you know, what we can see in the theater. So think about that and we'll come back if you don't mind. I appreciate you sticking around. It's Pete Schwaba. I'm filling in for the Devil's Advocates. Dom and Crute are taking a well-earned break. We've got Badger football coming up at 6 o'clock. And in the second hour, Capital Times features editor and entertainment critic Rob Thomas will be joining us. But right now we've got Greg Glienna. Stick around, folks. We'll be right back.
The Devil's Advocates, rock and roll political commentary in a top 40 world.
I'm so happy 'cause today. Welcome back, folks. Pete Schwaba sitting in today for Dom and Crute and the Devil's Advocates. Hey, if you haven't checked out the morning show here at WGBW or on the Civic Media app, it's Mino and the Mayor. If you haven't downloaded the Civic Media app, highly recommend it. Very easy to use, user-friendly, great shows, and you can access all the stations under the Civic Media umbrella. Badger football coming up at 6 o'clock, and Rob Thomas from the Capital Times coming up at 5:30, just after 5:30. Right now, we are talking to Greg Glienna. He is the founder or the creator of the Meet the Parents franchise. He's got a couple of films just being released, in the process of being released. One is Puppy Love, which you can see on Freevee, and the other is The Road Dog. And Greg, thanks for sticking around for another segment. You tell us where we can see The Road Dog.
The Road Dog is coming out on streaming October 6th, and it'll be on all these platforms, DirecTV, Apple TV, Amazon, Cox, Comcast, Vudu, Hoopla, Sling, YouTube. So it's out there. It's called The Road Dog, starring Doug Stanhope, who is a brilliant actor. I don't know if you are aware of that.
Yeah.
Great comedian, but he's really a great, great actor.
He is.
Go ahead.
No, he underplayed a lot of stuff. I was very impressed. I had no idea what it was going to be like with him acting. But when I got there to do my scene, it was fun getting to yell at him in my scene as the comedy club owner. But Doug was great. He was really fun.
Did you
fun.
See
so,
the movie?
Yeah, I did. It's great. I
did
loved
you
it.
See the finish? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, he's a wonderful actor. I mean, he's the kind of actor as a director I didn't have to do anything. He was great from the first read through the first. You know, rehearsal, he was great every take. And I've directed Academy Award winning actors, and he was as good as Kathy Bates to me or any of these people.
Yeah, and you got to direct Danny DeVito too. How cool was that?
Yes, he was great.
So Greg, okay, so tell us, that's another film of Greg's you can check out called Relative Strangers, Danny DeVito, Kathy Bates. Greg was nice enough to throw me a bone on that one too. And I played a meat delivery guy, which I think I knocked out of the park. But, so right. Greg, what are you watching? What is a guy like Greg Glienna? You've created these great movies. You've been in show business your whole adult life, stand up. What are you watching? What should people be watching right now? Either streaming in the theaters, go.
You know, I've been so busy with this film. I recently binged, Louis, which I think is one of the great TV shows of all time, if you've ever seen it, with Louis C.K. What did I just watch? Oh, the second, what's that movie with, what are the movies with Denzel Washington?
Oh, The Equalizer.
That's an Equalizer. I saw the part two, and I thought that was really entertaining, and I want to go see part three in the theaters. But I've been so busy with this film, just finishing it, cutting a trailer, doing it's that I haven't really been watching much, and I guess what I watched didn't make a big impression on me because I can't think of anything.
Oh, that was really worth keeping you around for another segment. Thanks, Greg.
yes, but October 6th, that's important.
Yeah, that, there you go. That's important. I'll tell you what, I loved all the Equalizer films. I saw the first two. They are so, I mean, Denzel Washington's great. The stories are fun. They're so beautifully shot. Mm-hmm. And the cinematography is so great.
Right.
The third one, I say, we were talking about this. I think a caller said he liked it. The third one is great. It's set in a small town in Italy. I did say there is a bit of a roadhouse element to it. But other than that, I really liked it. The trilogy is phenomenal. So, right. And what was the other one you said you saw?
Louis.
Oh, Louis.
Have you seen Louis C.K.'s show?
I saw it when it was on before genius. All the controversy. Like, then I just felt kind of creepy watching the I don't think enough time has gone by.
I mean,
yet
it's like it would be hysterically funny, and then it's serious, and then it's sad, then it's unlike any other show that I
do remember that of. Yeah, it was a good show for sure. Did you see any of the summer blockbusters, Greg?
Yes.
What did you see?
I saw the Mission Impossible.
Great film,
which I thought was good but over long.
Yeah, that's true.
Remind me what else is out. Like,
well, I'll tell you what I saw. I saw Barbenheimer. I saw Barbie, Oppenheimer, Meg 2. I dragged my wife and kids to.
No.
That's laughably bad. I'm convinced it was written by AI. And then I saw Equalizer 3. Honestly, it was so bad. Like I say, if they would just get rid of the dialogue, the film would be watchable. That's how bad it was. And
you
then
know,
yeah,
movie I absolutely loved was Violent Night.
Oh, that was great. I love that movie. Yeah, David Harbour.
Yeah, I thought that was a movie that should have been like Meg, you know. That was just a really entertaining film, I thought.
Really fun. Totally
In
agree.
Fact, that's one of the last films that I can think of that I've seen in the theater.
Yeah, no, that was phenomenal. So if you guys want to get on the conversation, it's 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. We want to know what you're watching and what you can recommend. You've been listening to us talk. Now tell us what you're watching, if you would. My guest has been Greg Glienna. Greg, this has been so much fun. Thank you for taking the time out to talk about your many movies. Next time we'll have to tell some more fun Hollywood stories.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, anytime, buddy. Thanks, Greg. So, Nate, we got to get more people. I know we got a few texts. What are people watching? Did I see a Succession text?
Oh yeah. We've been getting all sorts of political movies.
Let's go through them, man.
Coming through. We have, Enemy of the State with, Will Smith and Gene Hackman. All about how the government spies. That's we have Loved Once it. Upon a Time in America. That's from Dana in La Crosse. Once Upon a Time in America. Favorite weekend, rainy weekend movie is what Dana says. Once Upon a Time in America, which that's a good one. It's long. That's what long movies are really good for, is the nice rainy weekends like that, you know.
I love that she labeled it or branded it like that. That's feel free to do that, folks. Great rainy day movie. Well done, Dana. Thank you.
We also have a political comedy, I suppose, and that would be My Fellow Americans, Jack Lemmon, Dan Aykroyd, of them. I don't believe I've seen that one, actually.
I have not either.
And that's from Jim from Appleton. I don't believe I've seen that one, but Dan Aykroyd, he can either be really good or really bad, but I'm going to have to put that one on there. So
I think he's good. He does bad films, which I don't really typically put on the actor, but
I've seen nothing but trouble.
That's right. Was that the Wisconsin movie?
Nothing but Trouble. No, that was the weird one that he wrote it and John Candy is in it and Demi Moore is in it. It's real bad. It's something.
That's great. Oh, Dana from La Crosse is a guy. Apologies, Dana.
Yes.
Thank you for pointing that out, though. But I don't know. I pictured the rainy day thing. I just felt like that was like a cup of tea. That was a great way to label that. So we're going to come back. We're going to do a quick break here, folks. It's Pete Schwaba. I'm in for Dom and Crute. The Devil's Advocates are taking some time. They're advocating for themselves today and taking a day off. So good for them. Badger football at 6. Rob Thomas coming up to talk more movies and TV at 5:30. We want to hear from you. 844-967-2789. Let us know what you're watching. We'll be right back. It's Pete Schwab and the Devil's Advocate.
Greg, thank you so much for coming on the show today. We really appreciate it. All right, awesome. Now I got to read the news here, so I got to let you go. But thank you so much for joining us.
All right, have a good one.
Test, 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 test.
Find out what's going on in the world, the state,
and in your own backyard.
This is a Civic Media Network News Update.
It's 5 o'clock. Good afternoon. I'm Nate Wuggehout, and here's what Wisconsin needs to know. The nationwide United Auto Workers strike has come to Wisconsin. Stuart J. Waddles reports.
UAW members in Milwaukee and in a town near the Twin Cities went on strike this morning. GM has a parts distribution center in Hudson, Wisconsin, employing about 70 UAW members. Stellantis, the company making Jeeps, Dodges, and Chryslers, maintains a Mopar warehouse in Milwaukee. There's about 100 UAW workers now on strike there. The labor action is expected to impact other automotive-related businesses. Stuart J. Waddles, Civic Media News.
There's a movement to curb corporate ownership of farmland in the United States. The Farmland for Farmers Act in Congress would restrict the amount of agricultural land corporations can own. Hannah Breckbell is a rural advocate in Decorah, Iowa.
Land prices have been going up and up and up. In my career as a farmer, which is not very long, only about a decade, I've seen land prices more than double. and we need farmers to be on the ground owning land.
Supporters hope the Farmland for Farmers Act is adopted as part of the new farm bill, which lawmakers are scheduled to take up this month. Democratic lawmakers are once again pushing to legalize recreational marijuana in Wisconsin. Senate Minority Leader Melissa Agard introduced the bill earlier today. She says the state is missing out on tax dollars that could be generated from taxing marijuana. Agard has introduced similar bills in the past, and they've all been quickly dismissed by Republicans. It's cranberry harvest time in Wisconsin. As meteorologist Brittany Merlot reports, the cranberry is a complex fruit that requires special treatment, equipment, and process to gather.
This year's harvest is expected to exceed last year's, up about 100,000 to 4.9 million barrels. But farmers have still had their fair share of difficulties fighting against the drought conditions most of the summer. With very little rain, their ponds are down. The booming industry is one of a kind here in the Badger State, but especially in central Wisconsin. The executive director of Wisconsin State Cranberry Growers Association says cranberries are the state's largest fruit crop. It's the official state fruit, and Wisconsin leads the world in cranberry production. With a little over 60% of the U.S. crop this year, it's a billion-dollar industry here in Wisconsin, providing thousands of jobs for residents. I'm meteorologist Brittany Merlot, Civic Media News.
The Mount Horeb School District in Dane County was briefly put on hold today after threats were made to schools in western Wisconsin. Nobody was allowed in or out of any district buildings for about an hour this morning. No threats were made against the school, but officials decided to go on hold out of caution. A Madison teen was arrested for making threats against specific students at schools in Grant County. Nate Wegehout, Civic Media News. Hey, Greg, so would you still have Danny coming up next?
Oh, it's Pete, Nate. Oh, yeah,
all right, Danny. Pete, yeah.
Yes. And is
what did I call you?
He called me Greg, which is funny. He called my house once and he addressed me as him. He said, "Hey, Greg, it's Pete," which is weird. It's so funny you just said that. Is Crute just texted me. Is it 844-96-PARTY?
Yes. Yep. Oh, we can do that too.
Perfect.
Same thing.
Good to know.
So it's still Danny next?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I don't know.
And if you got that number? It's a landline. It's the 906 one.
Yeah, I think I might have to call her once the show gets started going. So
that's fine.
Yeah, we should be okay because you're going to be introducing the show and stuff. So
yeah.
But yeah, we got about 40 seconds here. Good first half of the show.
Do you think it went okay?
Yeah, no, I thought it went good.
Good. I will say it's I got to get used to the delay a little bit. It's a weird.
Yeah, like that's talking over. Yeah, people. That's the one thing. But, okay, here we go. Coming back.
Okay.
Warning, you are about to listen to the greatest radio show ever.
And due to contractual obligations and to shield our airwaves and corporate licensees from any semblance of liability, responsibility, and gullibility, we must tell you the views represented on this show are not necessarily those of this station or its management. This radio show contains differing points of view on current political topics, and due to the nature of its contents, it should be heard by everyone. Thank you for listening. Now live from the Devil Radio Studios in Madison, Wisconsin, where the political party is just beginning. Welcome to the Devil's Advocate Show. Friends proving it's never personal, only politics.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
Here is your host, Mike Crute.
Welcome back to the show. I am not Mike Crute. I am Pete Schwaba filling in for Mike Crute and Dom. On the Devil's Advocate today. The guys are taking a day off. They'll be back Monday. So in their absence, what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to provide a service. I'm trying to find out what you're watching, what people are watching, because one of my pet peeves is that when I sit down to watch TV, I scroll, I look at Hulu for 10 minutes, HBO for 15 minutes, then I go to Apple or Paramount for another. It's an hour before I finally decide on something to watch. And I end up falling asleep anyway. So I want to know, let's help each other out here. By the end of this show, I'm going to give you three suggestions of what I'm watching, what Nate, the producer, is watching, what our guests are watching. We'll come up with a composite list, and we'll tell you guys something that you can watch. And you could sign off or stick around for Badger Football at 6 o'clock on the Civic Media app. Go to WRJN and tune in for the Badgers. And after the Badgers, you know, you'll have a movie to watch. You won't waste any time. You'll sit down, you'll start it, stop the scroll, start the stream. That's what I say. So that's what we're talking about. Feel free to text or call in, share your thoughts with us. It's 844-967-2789. I criticized the phone number before, and Mike Crute, who's supposed to be relaxing today, has texted me for the second time and said it's 844-96-PARTY. So it's actually a great phone number and very easy to remember. So apologies to the devils who have just advocated for themselves and their phone number. It's a great phone number. So we just talked to Greg Glienna, the creator of Meet the Parents. We talked to Mike Clemens. Coming up this hour, we're going to talk to Rob Thomas. He is the features editor for the Capital Times. He handles all the entertainment stuff. He does movie and TV show reviews, and he's a great interview. He'll be with us a little bit after 5:30. Like I said, Badger football is coming up at 6. And in the meantime, we're going to talk to you guys. We want to hear from you. We want you to text. We want you to call. We had some great calls the first hour, some really good texts. And one person, Dana, a guy from La Crosse, labeled or branded his movie. He said, what was the movie, Nate?
It was let me go back. No. Once Upon a Time in America.
Once Upon a Time in America. And he said, that's great a great movie. Day. To just on a rainy day to watch that movie.
Rainy weekend movie.
That's it. And that, you're not kidding, Nate. That thing is a marathon. Like you think it's hard to carve out 3 hours. I think it's 4+, isn't it? Or I don't know. It's a great film.
Like that.
But you got to pack a lunch.
That's one that's worth it. Every once in a while, there's one that's worth it. And that is one that's worth it.
We'll talk mob movies at some point too. That's a great one. But right now we are gonna bring another guest onto the show. This is a treasure in Wisconsin that we have this. We have so much great theater here and great talent. And right here in Northeast Wisconsin, just down the road here from the WGBW studios, we have the Peninsula Players, who are in Fish Creek or very close to Fish Creek. I've been there. It's a great outdoor theater, tons of history, the most charming place, one of them that you can go in Wisconsin. It's a great excursion. And she is the development director of the Peninsula Players Theater. Her name is Danielle Szmanda, and she is joining us now. Danielle, how bad did I get your last name?
Not too bad, Pete. It's Szmanda. Thank you so much for having me on, and thank you for your kind words about the Players.
Oh, listen, first of all, I want to say I have a history. I spent the first part of my childhood in Chicago, then moved to Marinette. And I went to Marinette Catholic Central High School, and I was in the theater company. Back then, you could do sports and theater and student government. You could kind of do everything because you could kind of, you know, mail in a lot of stuff. It wasn't like you had to train for one sport or just do theater. It was great. So
But we went to our theater director, whose name was Jandice Jardin. She took us to Peninsula Players Theater. I think it was like in March or April to help them get ready for their season, because it's an outdoor theater, and we cleaned up everything. We raked, and her friend, she had done theater in New York. Her friend was running the theater, the Peninsula Players, at the time. So we had this great experience and saw this really cool place. I don't know that I appreciated it when I was 16 or 17, but I took my daughter to see Dames at Sea there about 3 or 4 weeks ago. What a fun night that was. You guys just have such a sweet spot there on the peninsula. And just, I just want to jump in. I've been talking too much. Tell us about Peninsula Players and what you do, Danielle.
Absolutely. It's, yeah, like you said, Pete, it's a really, truly beautiful and magical spot. Peninsula Players is America's oldest professional resident summer theater. This is our 88th season.
Oh my gosh.
The theater was founded in 1935 by Caroline and Richard Fisher, a brother and sister duo. And it was truly a family affair. Caroline was an actor, and Richard acted as the theater's artistic director. So he directed a lot of the shows. He wrote a couple of plays as well. And when Caroline was not busy acting on stage, she ran the business portion of the theater. And their mother made the costumes and fed the company, and their father was the handyman. So it was all hands on deck for the creation of the theater. And then we've been in this location since 1937. It was actually an old boys' camp, Camp Wildwood for boys, settled here on the shores of Green Bay. And so, yeah, the property has that very rustic and charming feeling. And then when you arrive on property in the evening, what makes Peninsula Players so unique and so special is it is a full experience. We have this beautiful beer garden right along the shore that patrons are welcome to come and picnic. We ask that you do not bring in your own alcohol because of the Wisconsin state statute, but we do have a full service bar right on property. People can picnic before the show, watch the sunset along the water, and then the whole property has twinkle lights, and the sun sets and the lights come on, and it is truly a unique experience. And after that beautiful pre-show experience, you get to walk into the theater. Depending on the weather, we've got these big side walls that go up and down. And during the summer months, we keep them often open as often as possible. So when you're sitting in your theater seat, you're watching the production, and you can see the gardens and grounds outside as well. It's truly one of a kind.
It's really incredible. And I'll be honest, I'm an inside guy. So when I decided to take my daughter there a few weeks ago, I was like, oh, is it going to be buggy? It's not. And you guys have, since I was there as a kid, you've built it up so much, but you still get a sense of the outdoors. Like, you're completely outdoors, and the theater is beautiful.
So I
would encourage people, if they haven't done this, truly is a treasure in Northeast Wisconsin. It's Peninsula Players. Go to the website, and you guys have a video there, and the video just does a great job of showing the beauty in the area and the setting of the theater. So I would encourage everyone to go there and check it out. So tell us a little bit about your season is winding down here. I think you close October 15th. Tell us what we can see there and what's left this year.
Absolutely. We have our final production going on right now, which is Ken Ludwig's Baskerville, a Sherlock Holmes mystery. And it is exactly that. It is Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's classic thriller, The Hound of Baskervilles, and a take on that story with Sherlock Holmes. Love but he it. Has also added some comedic elements throughout the production. So you are truly getting the full Sherlock Holmes experience with these comedic elements that just keep you so engaged and so entertained throughout. It's a funny and thrilling production. perfect for the fall season. We play Tuesdays through Sundays at 7 o'clock, except for October 1st and October 15th. We will have a 2 o'clock matinee for people to come enjoy. Perfect for a lot of the folks there in Green Bay if they just want to come up for the day and then they don't have to spend overnight if they don't want to, and make a day trip out of it, which is really the awesome part about our location as well. It's pretty accessible.
Yeah, it really is. And the during intermission, we loved the you guys put a big bonfire. It's just it's a really incredible experience. So is it heated, Danielle? Because I know, or do you guys just close it up if it gets too cold? Because let's be honest, I mean, October in Wisconsin, you could get snow.
Yeah, no, that's a great question, Pete. So for the majority of our fall season, we do have the sides fully closed. So then you are in a fully enclosed space. And then we also do have in-floor radiant heat. So that helps take the chill out of the air. But like you said, Pete, being in Wisconsin in the fall, we always recommend that people dress for the weather, bring an extra layer, or even a blanket if you think you'll need one, just because our lobby is all outdoors. So you will be spending time outside before you enter the theater. Right. But the theater itself stays very comfortable.
But and it's theater, so go nuts. Just be warm, but you know, wear what you want. No one's going to judge you if you show up in, you know, leg warmers and a cape, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay. Comfort is key.
So Danielle, the whole point of the show is we're trying to help people find stuff to watch, and we want to hear what other people are watching. Are you into any shows right now? We have about a minute left, and we love having you here. Real quick, are you watching anything right now that you could refer us to?
Oh my gosh, like television or movies?
Yeah, or movies.
Wow. Well, I have to do a big shout out to the Barbie movie. It was fantastic. It was a really, really great movie. Very fun, very entertaining. I haven't caught the double feature of that and Oppenheimer yet.
Yeah.
But I heard that it's an interesting juxtaposition
duo. I totally agree. Danielle, thank you so much for being with us today, and best of luck and continued success at Peninsula Players.
Thanks for having me on, Pete. I appreciate it.
Anytime. So when we come back, we're going to play a game called Guess the Scene, and we want to hear from you. We want you to call us 844-967-2789. It's Pete Schwaba filling in for Dominic Crute on the Devil's Advocate.
I'll get those clips ready for you to go. And
yeah, you want to do Groundhog Day first, Nate?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any music requests coming back? Oh, wait, no, we had that song, right?
Yeah.
Never mind.
Ooh, that's good. That's give a little, a good hint, too. But it hasn't always been this easy. Back in the mid-1800s, the berries had to be picked by hand. It took another 100 years for the right equipment to be built to help with the
We are coming to see Show Mark at some point, so I will say hi. Thanks so much. Massachusetts, which has been number two ever since. By the way, cranberry is the official state.
I'm Terry Barr for the Civic Media Radio. Am I promoting everything enough, Nate? Otherwise, cloudy skies expected. Lows dip down to about 61. Winds out of the southeast, 8 to 15 miles an hour. Scattered thunderstorms, high temperatures reach up to 70. Partly cloudy skies tomorrow night. Lows level off around 57.
Malarkey. The devil's advocates invented malarkey.
L is for the way you look.
Welcome back to the Devil's Advocate. The Devil's Advocate light today. I'm Pete Schwaba, filling in for Dom and Crute. They will be back Monday. And we have done a bit of a turn here on the show, so don't panic, folks. It's still a political show. But we're talking about movies and streaming shows today, and we're trying to help people find out what they should be watching and also what we should be watching. Don't hesitate to call or text us your suggestions. 844-96-PARTY. That's the better way to say it. 844-96-PARTY. Text us your suggestions of what to watch. It could be political movies, since this is a political show. It could be summer blockbuster that you liked. Something you're streaming on Netflix or HBO or looking forward to. We want to hear it all. And we'll give you three great suggestions by the end of this show that you could just run to and start watching right away and don't have to spend an hour looking for something to watch. So we are going to, I've been looking forward to this. Nate Wagehout is the producer, folks. Nate, we've talked about this. It's finally here. The dream is real. We're going to play Guess the Scene. So how this works is Nate is going to play a clip. And if you know the scene, we want to hear from you. We want you to text us or call us, 844-96-PARTY, and tell us what scene it is. Are there prizes? Oh, no. We don't have that kind of budget, folks. But you get the personal satisfaction of guessing the right answer. And down the road, maybe we'll do something like that, movie tickets or something. But okay, Nate, fire up the first scene and listen up, folks. Here we go.
This is Doris. Her brother-in-law, Carl, owns this diner. She's worked here since she was 17. More than anything else in her life, she wants to see Paris before she dies.
Oh, boy, what are you doing?
This is Debbie Kleiser and her fiancé, Fred.
Do I know you?
They're supposed to be getting married this afternoon, but Debbie is having second thoughts.
What?
Lovely ring.
This is Bill. He's been a waiter for 3 years since he left Penn State and had to get work. He likes the town, he paints toy soldiers, and he's gay.
I am.
This is Gus. He hates his life here. He wishes he stayed in the Navy.
Well, I could have retired on half pay after 20 years.
Excuse me? Is this some kind of trick?
Well, maybe the real God uses tricks. You know, maybe he's not omnipotent. He's just been around so long. He knows everything.
Okay, there you go. There's the scene. So if you think you know it, let us. Oh, we already have a winner. Nate. Who was that? The text disappeared so fast. Groundhog's Day. No, that's... That All is right. correct. We've had two people guess it right, correct?
We also have We also have a caller on the line who also thinks they know it. So I don't think we've said it quite yet. So do we want to? We have Terry here. Terry from our car.
Definitely Bill Murray.
It was definitely Bill Murray, but what's the movie, Terry? Is it Terry or Carrie?
Oh, yeah.
Terry.
Groundhog Day, without a doubt. Yeah.
Well done, young lady. That's excellent.
Thanks. Okay.
Terry, give us a suggestion of what we can watch. What are you watching right now?
Oh, my gosh. Actually, I'm going to be watching the Badger game tonight.
Hey, nothing wrong with that. That's entertaining, and you don't know how it ends. That's what I love about sports.
Right.
Terry, thanks so much. Thanks for the call. Drive safely, okay? All right.
And Pete, where can people hear the Badger game tonight? I hear it starts at 6 o'clock.
I think I have that information right on the Civic Media app on WRJN. That would be my suggestion. That's the best place to listen to it. And I will give you those call letters momentarily. WRJN AM 1400, AM 1400. If you're in your car or on the Civic Media app, that's a great place to listen to it too. So, wow, that was great. Everybody, nobody guessed wrong. We had three or four people all pegged it as
that was an easy one though.
That was kind of an easy one. See, I didn't know. I don't know what, you know, you don't know how intense. All right, let's do the second one, Nate. Let's do another one and see if people can get this one.
The next one's a little bit more difficult. Here we go.
Okay.
What's up? I never yield it. And as you can see, I am not dead.
That is, I mean, I thought people would get it just from that, and maybe they will. That's a pretty, it's kind of iconic.
Here's a hint that will help no one. I haven't actually seen this movie.
Yeah, well, I picked it out, and I was like, oh, what is this one again? Okay, yeah. So, so there you go. There's a clip, and let's see if anybody can guess that one. Should we give the actor? Should we give a hint, Nate?
We have Madison Plummer saying Blood Diamond. That is incorrect.
Blood Diamond is incorrect.
Oh, but we do have a winner here. I'm not quite sure what their name is, but they did guess correctly there, and that would be Black Panther.
Black Panther.
Yes. Did not include their name in there, but
There's nothing wrong with
that. Is correct.
Anonymity. I got to be honest, the Marvel movies, I'm not anti-Marvel, but Black Panther is one of the most, that and Wonder Woman, I remember, because it's like about one person. It's not like where they're all together and they all just, the movies kind of blend together to me. We get somebody else here.
It was Andrew from Verona. Good job, Andrew. That was a shorter one, I think.
Yeah.
And I think that's good. And
he gets credit for that one.
Yes.
So that's good. He gets credit for that. And now he did not label it or brand it. Black Panther is the kind of movie where you, let's say, we need Dana's help here from lacrosse, because that was a rainy weekend movie. Black Panther is a Friday night. Have a couple of other couples over, lots of popcorn, and watch an action movie. That's how I'm going to brand that.
Yeah, it's a good popcorn movie.
Exactly. Should we try to do, I want to do one of the, Rob Thomas is coming up next, folks. He's the features editor at the Capital Times.
I think we're just out of time for doing another one here. Yeah.
Okay, let's hold it over. We'll see if Rob can guess it, and we can take some calls too. That's good. Perfect branding. Okay. All right. So I'm Pete Schwaba filling in for Dom and Crute. How are we doing on time, Nate? Do we have to go right now?
No, we got a couple seconds.
Should I sing something?
Can sing a little something.
Oh, and great actor lost. See, that's the irony of that clip. Is he says, "I am not dead," and I'm completely blanking on his name right now, but he did pass away. Mm-hmm. Phenomenal actor who was also in Jackie. Not Jackie. I think it was called 41. Anyway, all right. So great job with Guess the Scene, everybody. We got Groundhog Day and Black Panther, and we'll have another one in the next segment. Rob Thomas is going to join us. He's the features editor for the Cap Times. And if Rob, we're going to put Rob on the spot, because if he doesn't know this, yes, Bozeman. I'm still blanking on his first name. Help me out, folks. And I just got a text from someone too, said Lioness is a great movie to check out. So there you go. All right. So we're going to do another Guess the Scene coming up next. It's Pete Schwaba in for Dom and Crute. We'll be right back with Rob Thomas.
L is for the way you look at me. O is for the only.
Nate, I'm sorry. I looked away from you and I couldn't remember where we were in the countdown. So I'm sorry if I bailed too early.
No, that's okay. I sort of lost track of time there as well. So no.
My sister said she actually was on the line. Was there a call we didn't get to?
Oh, yeah, there's two on there. There's a Molly Walsh on right now.
Oh, that's my sister. All right, well, funny.
I'm going to call Rob real quick.
Okay, thanks.
All right, Rob is on the line.
Perfect.
Is there any music we want to come back to? Anything specific?
Oh, man.
Give me a band.
The Bodines. You know them?
Bodines. I saw the Bodines in like a high school gymnasium.
Oh, nice. They did music for a movie I did. I hired Kurt Newman. He wrote a score and gave me a bunch of Bodine songs. He's a great guy. I don't listen to them much anymore, though, since they broke up. So we've got Rob until 7:48.
Come on.
Hey, Nate.
Yeah.
So the last segment I have, what can you not turn off? It's a short segment, so maybe we'll do that. And then you can talk about, you know, if we don't get any calls or whatever, maybe you could talk about Halloween and what you're excited about. You know,
I mean, what I can't turn off is Star Trek.
Obviously. Yeah.
I just started Deep Space Nine again last night.
Again. So how long has it been since you've seen it?
2 months. Since the last time I watched it. It's one of those shows. I just watch it. I just put it on.
Wow. Nice, dude. That's how it is for me with crime shows or like Bosch. Have you ever seen Bosch?
Oh yeah.
Love that show.
All right. We got about 20 seconds here.
It's like comfort food.
You're listening to the radio show your mother warned you about, The Devil's Advocates.
Welcome back to the show. The Devil's Advocates are not here today. They'll be back Monday. Dom and crew taking some time off. I am Pete Schwaba, and we are talking. We did a little bit of a pivot today. We're talking show business and movies and streaming and entertainment and having all kinds of fun. We had the creative director for the Peninsula Players, Greg Glienna, created Meet the Parents. Now we are going to welcome in another, and we're going to see if we just did a segment called Guess the Scene, Nate. And we have one scene we didn't get to because we had so many great calls and texts. We're going to play this and we're going to put Rob Thomas on the spot and see if he can guess the scene. He is the great features editor for the Capital Times. Please welcome to the show, Rob Thomas. Rob, how are you?
I'm good, Pete. This is not fair to put me on the spot like this.
Hey, we'll
my
see.
My reputation's on the line.
Put your money where your mouth is, buddy. You write about movies and TV. You know, you've interviewed me a couple times over the years. You did a hit job. I've forgiven you for it, but I want to make things right here tonight. So. No, it's great to have you, buddy. Okay. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me, Pete. It's good to talk to you again.
Yeah, my pleasure. Likewise. So you have something you want to talk about, too. I said I wanted to pick your brain and see what you were watching, but something's going on at the Capital Times, right?
Yeah, we have a big week this week. It's CapTimes Idea Fest in Madison, which started Saturday. And then tonight we have a big event with a senator named Bernie Sanders, a big sold-out thing at Shannon Hall.
That's
and
right.
Then tomorrow's the last day with a whole lineup of great speakers, including Adam Kinziger, who was on the January 6th commission.
Sure.
And some local legislators and the author of a new biography of Martin Luther King Jr. And then we have a bunch of virtual events. If people want to stay home, they can watch it online. So we plan all year for this, and attendance has been great so far this week. We've been really happy with it. So
couldn't
come on out. It's really fun.
Couldn't you get any better guests, bigger names there, or what's going on? That's a great lineup. And Adam Kinziger is a phenomenal follow on Twitter, by the way.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's great. Good luck with that.
Yeah, it's going to be fine.
Excellent. So Rob, typically, I'm sure you're familiar with The Devil's Advocate. It's typically a political show. You know my background and what I like to talk about. So that's what we're doing today. And I want to pick your brain. I want to give people three suggestions they can walk away with after the show that they cannot scroll for 45 minutes and check every app on Roku before they decide on something. So I'm just going to ask you right out of the gate, what is Rob Thomas watching right now? Movie, TV, whatever.
Well, my wife and I just finished a Netflix show, and this is political. called The Diplomat with Kerry Russell.
Oh, yeah.
We thought it was great. We thought it was great. She plays the U.S. ambassador to the United Kingdom, gets involved in all this intrigue. It's dramatic. It's very funny. I thought it was very smart, really well written. So we really like that. I mean, these days, if we finish a series, that's like show of the year, because usually it's like we get halfway through and then we get distracted by something else. And we finished all 8 episodes of that and are ready for season 2. And then right now I'm watching this comedy on Peacock, which is the NBC streaming site, which I know a lot of people probably don't have, but it's called Killing It with Craig Robinson from The Office and Hot Tub Time Machine. It's really funny and really sweet. He plays a guy in the South who's kind of trying to make it big. The first season he was like killing snakes. This season it's about these berries. It's really, really well written. It has a lot of the charm, I think, of The Office or like Parks and Rec, something like that. So that's one I really like as well.
That's great. Did you see the summer blockbusters? I assume you saw your share of them.
I did. I saw Barbenheimer, I saw Barbie twice, once with my daughters. We got the pink out, and then once with my wife. And then I saw Oppenheimer with my wife. And I mean, what a great summer for movies at the theater. Like, it was, first of all, great movies. And then it was so fun to see these packed theaters and packed lobbies and everybody, you know, young, old, coming out and movies. I mean, really restored my faith in what, you know, after kind of a rough couple of years with the pandemic, restored my faith that people can see, you know, how special it is to go see movies with a bunch of strangers in a movie theater, especially when they're good movies.
I totally agree. It's like, to me, that's half the fun. Like, I love streaming and binge watching at home, but there's nothing like having the cinema experience. I got to tell you, I had maybe you can relate to this, Rob. I don't know if you wore pink. I don't own pink. I have peach. I have a peach colored shirt and it looks dynamite, but it's not pink. So I didn't wear it. I was the only one, like 9 people, my daughter, my wife, friends. And then I look like that guy that refuses to wear pink. And I'm not. I just didn't have time to run out and buy something pink. And my wife's like, well, put on the peach shirt. I'm like, then I look like I'm an idiot. You know, like, no, it's pink, moron. So that's my thing with that. And then go ahead.
No, I just said I thought I was in the same boat. I thought I did not own any pink. And then I dug in my closet and I found a shirt I had bought for $3 on clearance at Old Navy that was bright pink and had not worn since I had bought it. And like, it was like destiny that I found that. Like, it earned its $3 that night for sure. So
that is money well spent, buddy. I think you got your use out of that for $3.
Absolutely.
I'm going to put this out to you too, because I think I've gone through Tom Cruise, an array of views on this guy. Liked him in Risky Business. Okay. All the Right Moves. Great. Then he got, you know, so strange, and it was his behavior on Oprah and the Scientology stuff. And I'm like, oh man, it's like, I can't watch this guy. I've come 360 back around. He is maybe the greatest movie star ever. He does not make a bad movie. You might not love every movie he makes, but I mean, even like my daughter likes Cocktail, and I'm like, the guy has not made a lemon. Has he? I mean, am I wrong? Am I missing something?
I mean, you know, this last 10 years, I think, especially since he got back to the Mission Impossible movies, which I love and watch over and over again.
Same.
And of course, Top Gun Maverick, which basically saved movies last year.
Yeah.
It's funny. He just kind of was like, I'll just pretend I don't have any sort of personal life whatsoever. And I'll just focus on the movies, and it's worked out. I mean, he makes one banger after another. I kind of thought Mission Impossible kind of got a little bit overlooked this summer, which is strange to say, because it came out the week before Barbenheimer and just wiped it out of theaters. You know, I was just, you know, I'm not going to cry for Tom Cruise, but you know, it's a great movie. I think people should catch up with that. I think it's going to be on DVD next month, and I think it's still in a couple of theaters. But yeah, I mean, he's as close to a sure thing in an age where there aren't that many of what you can call movie stars anymore. He's as close to a sure thing as you can get, I think.
And not only is he a bona fide, legit movie star, he's a pretty good actor too. I mean, because there can be a difference there. And I think like the first Mission Impossible, okay. The second one was terrible. I think that's the last and maybe only Tom Cruise movie I think was really bad.
Yeah. I mean, there were some, like the second Jack Reacher movie, which nobody saw, wasn't very good, but that was like 10 years ago. And like, he's just really focusing, I think, on, you know, A, learning how to jump out of an airplane or whatever. and he just kind of knows the assignment in every movie and picks very carefully. I'm very excited to see the part two of Mission Impossible whenever, I guess it's been delayed because of the strike, but very excited to see that whenever it comes out.
Yeah, it's the way that movie ended was phenomenal. I've never seen anything like that. So, Rob, I got to ask you this. So are you, have you watched anything lately we should avoid? Anything that's cringeworthy as opposed to binge-worthy?
Well, this is very divisive, but I have really started to sour. If you have Disney Plus, the Star Wars and Marvel TV shows, like, in Star Wars, I don't know if you've kept up, but like Andor was a really good one. But I've been watching, I think it's pronounced Ahsoka.
With
Rosario Dawson.
Yep.
And I see some people online loving it, and I just cannot get into it. It's just like, it's so reliant on nostalgia for the movies and TV shows that have come before, when like, guys, it's been like 45 years since the first one. Let's move things forward a little bit.
Right.
And similarly with the Marvel one. There was one called Secret Invasion this summer with Samuel Jackson, who again you would think would be pretty close to a sure thing, and it was just a mess. It was like, started out as kind of like a Cold War thriller and then kind of turned halfway, and I think they're trying to set up future movies and TV shows, but I've been real skeptical of those lately. But you know, obviously they have their fans, so you know, I usually will hear about it online if I dare criticize.
Yeah, I'm with you. The new one, Ahsoka, I've seen a few episodes. It's just kind of like, it just kind of drags, you know? Go ahead, Rob. Sorry.
No, I wasn't saying anything.
So, hey, can we do, will you be a good sport and do Guess the Scene? Nate, are you there?
Bring it. Yep. Bring it.
Okay.
Bring it.
Yeah, we'll see. All right. I think he's going to get this. I'll even give you a hint if you need it, Rob. But let's play the scene for Rob and see how it goes.
Second of all, these people don't dream about being rich. They dream about being able to watch their kids swim in a pool without worrying that they'll have to have a hysterectomy at the age of 20, like Rosa Diaz, a client of ours, or have their spine deteriorate like Stan Bloom, another client of ours. So before you come back here with another lame-ass offer, I want you to think real hard about what your spine is worth, Mr. Walker, or what you might expect someone to pay you for your uterus, Miss Sanchez. Then you take out your calculator and you multiply that number by 100. Anything less than that is a waste of our time. By the way, we had that water brought in special for you folks. Came from Well and Hinckley.
All right. Rob, lay it on us.
I am 80% sure that that's Aaron Brockovich.
You are 80%, 100% right. That's excellent.
And shout out to Dana from La Crosse as well, who got it like halfway through the clip.
I know. This guy must just watch movies.
Faster than me, Dana. I needed a few lines before I got it.
She was just in Northeast Wisconsin here, and there's a big, as we know, the PFAS issue. So that's a great movie to revisit maybe if people are looking for something. So, Rob, let's talk. We just got a couple minutes here. Film festivals. What's your favorite Wisconsin film festival? You seem to be all over the place. I've seen you at the Wisconsin one a few times. What do you think?
I've primarily been to the Wisconsin Film Festival here in Madison, which I love. I've been to every single one. The Milwaukee Film Festival, also a great one. I don't get to that one every year, but that's a beautifully run one by Milwaukee Film.
Yeah.
You know, in the Oriental Theater. You can't beat that.
Gorgeous.
There's one in Mineral Point. I think it's in November, called the Driftless Film Festival.
That's a great one,
which is also very good. Yeah, and they've got, I saw they got David Strathairn, the actor from, he played Edward R. Murrow in Good Night and Good Luck. He's going to be there opening night, which is, there's a lot of like smaller festivals like that. Beloit has a really good one too, that are like, you know, Tom Cruise might not show up opening night, but you know, they still got a nice slate of independent or classic movies. And the nice thing is, you know, people are going to show up. So, you know, you're going to see a movie with a full house.
Yeah. You know, it's great. The Driftless one is great. It's at that little opera house, if I remember correctly. It's just beautiful right downtown.
Beautiful. Yeah, absolutely.
And I think Milwaukee and Madison too are both great. I had a film, The Godfather Green Bay, played in both of those festivals. I don't know if that happens anymore. Now I'm going back 15 years, but I don't think they do that anymore. There's like this rivalry, it seems like.
I think some they do. They're right next to each other. I mean, the reason I don't go to Milwaukee as much is it's right after the Madison one. And I'm worn out after seeing the movies in Madison.
I love the Wisconsin Film Festival.
Me too. Yeah.
And Milwaukee. I mean, they're all, and Driftless is great too, but it's, and David Strait Theron, that'll be fun. Boy, you got to get a picture with him. He's a phenomenal actor.
Yeah, he's fantastic. Yeah, that's really cool. I think the director of the festival has a connection with him, and they're showing a film they shot in Milwaukee. So that's very exciting. Yeah.
He played Pierce Patchett in L.A. Confidential, which is one of my all-time favorite movies, too. And, just a phenomenal actor. Rob, you're great, man. Keep up the great work. We love it. And thanks for – we're going to put The Diplomat out there to people. Thanks so much for your time today. Keep up the great work.
Thanks, Pete. Great talking to you.
Yeah. Okay, buddy. We'll see you. So there we go. We have two suggestions so far, Nate, and we'll get a third one in the next segment. We're going to find out what you can't turn off. So get ready to call or text. Pete Schwaba, sitting in for Dom and Crute. We'll be right back.
All right, final segment. Any musical requests?
How about Miles Davis? How about that Spanish Key? Have we heard that yet?
We have not.
So how about this, Nate? We'll do Parallax View, The Diplomat from Rob, and then Aaron Brockovich as our three suggestions.
Sure, that's a good one.
All right. Timely, or at least kind of timely because of all the crazy issues.
Oh, it was a Spanish what? Was
key.
Spanish Key, Miles Davis.
Yeah, that's it.
I'll just start from the beginning to start it. And we do have a caller on the line.
Oh, nice.
Put it in the chat there.
Eileen from Madison. Does she know what she wants to talk about? Or is she going to give a suggestion?
Not sure.
That's all right. We can bring her in. We'll ask her that question about what can't you turn off.
Yeah.
Thanks for the help today, Nate. Great job, man. It's been fun.
Yeah, of course. Show's been going good, I think, so far.
I hope so.
All right, here we go.
Grass-fed, locally raised, 100% organic. The Devil's Advocates.
Welcome back. Schwaba sitting in for Dom and Crute on The Devil's Advocate. They'll be back Monday. Badger football coming up in a few minutes. You can use the Civic Media app for that and go to WRJN or 1400 AM if you're down in that area. We are broadcasting live from the WGBW Talk of Green Bay Studios here at City Deck. Beautiful, beautiful evening. First day of fall, technically, although it feels like summer. Okay, we're in the home stretch here. Nate's been riding with me. Great job, Nate. It's been fun. And great stuff from Rob Thomas. So far, we've got two suggestions for people. We'll have a third one by the end of this segment, and then we'll just put them out there at the end of the show. So now, in the last few minutes we have together, thank you for listening, by the way. This has been a joy for me to talk movies and TV. I want to know, what can't you turn off? You're sitting on your couch, you're flipping around, and you come across that movie or that TV show where you're like, oh boy, I'll be up another hour. What is it? What show or movie can you not turn off? 844-96-PARTY, 844-967-2789. We have a caller. Let's take this call, Nate. Eileen from Madison. Hi, Eileen.
Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, you sound
okay.
Great.
You just mentioned the middle of the night movie, and this, I'll tell you real fast. I caught you the first couple of minutes of your show, and then I had to leave, and I came in an hour odd, and I'm so glad to finally talk to you. The movie I saw in the middle of the night is called North Country, and it happens in the mining industry in northern Minnesota. Charlize Theron, Sissy Spacek, Harrison, and Frances McDormand. And it is an absolutely incredible women's movement. And at the end, there is a disclaimer that what happened in the movie deals with probably one of the beginnings of the women's movement, and who would think it happened in northern Minnesota. If you get a chance to watch it, it's just, the whole premise of it is just excellent. It touches on several social problems, and the whole cast is just so extraordinary. So I know you have to go. Thank you so much. I wish
you're
I
could
have listened to your whole show. So thanks a lot, and carry on. Bye-bye.
All right. Thank you, Eileen. Be careful out there. North Country. That's a good one too, Nate. I do remember that. I don't think I saw it though. Did she say she saw me? Oh, I lost Nate for a second there. So that's Eileen. And then we have some text coming in too, but what is the movie or TV show for Eileen? It was North Country that you can't turn off. You want to go to bed, but oh man, The Godfather's on. That's definitely one of them with me, or Goodfellas, or here's a hidden movie too. Quick Change. One of my all time favorites. Very kind of flew under the radar. Bill Murray is the star of it. It's just about people that rob a bank that are trying to get out of New York City and the challenges they face. It's so great. Let's go to the phones again and take a call from Joanne in Madison. Hey, Joanne.
Greatest movie of all time, Wonder Boys. It's about higher education. It has Michael Douglas, Robert Downey Jr. You've got to watch it if you have any interest at all in higher education, because it says it as it is in higher education. And I actually met Michael Douglas and thanked him for the movie. He was over in building on the square, because he was opening up a political headquarters for Bloomberg when Michael Bloomberg was running. And
oh, wow.
Michael Douglas said it was one of his favorite movies as well. Incredibly well acted. Thank you so much for the fantastic program.
Hey, thank you for the call, Joanne. Have a great night.
Thanks.
I don't know if I should have, if this is appropriate, but I was in a men's room once with Michael Douglas. We were both at the urinals, and it wasn't probably the time to talk to him. So I just let it go, Nate. I said nothing. I let the man have his moment. That's not the right time to tell a guy that, hey, some people tell me I look like you. Well, we're both standing at urinals probably. But, so I steered clear. Did we get a text? I thought I saw a text come through too.
Oh, we've been getting all sorts of texts.
Read some of those. More suggestion.
Talking about Tom Cruise, Dana from La Crosse brought in Born on the 4th of July. He said he's one of all-time favorites.
That's a great film.
Dana in La Crosse. Chad from Stoughton says latest binge is Suits, and Star Trek Strange New Worlds is awesome, he says, which I have not seen that one yet. That's on my list. I heard it was pretty good. That's one of the newer Star Trek shows, which they've been doing. I really haven't been super keen on the newer Star Trek shows.
Really?
But I heard Strange New Worlds was a pretty good one, actually.
Okay. Well, you're the guy for Star Trek. And then what was his other suggestion? I wish I could see these.
Born on the 4th of July.
Born on the 4th of July, yeah. Uh-huh. Tom Cruise, right. And phenomenal acting in that, too. I mean, the guy is a movie star, but he was, I think he was Oscar nominated. I know he didn't win for that. I don't think he's ever won an Oscar for acting, but that was a great film, too. So if you have one, folks, we can still get you on here. We got a couple minutes left. Tell us what you can't turn off when you're watching something. For Joanne, it was Wonder Boys. For Eileen, it was North Country, a movie with Charlize Theron. So tell us what you're watching. What can't you turn off when you're scrolling
around? I have a show
around?
That I, I started the other night and I had to stop because I was watching with my girlfriend, but I am kind of obsessed with, and that's Interview with a Vampire.
Oh, I have not seen that. I
believe it came out last year, but it just started streaming on Max. It's based on the old 80s movie.
Yeah,
about it, but it is so far fantastic. It's, I think, 8 episodes, I think, something like that.
You know, do you have this issue? I have an issue sometimes when something's already been a movie, and I feel like mm-hmm. Hollywood does this way too much. There's so many great scripts floating around out there mm-hmm. that could be made. We've already seen this story, and I'm sure it's a great show. I'll probably watch it. I want to watch it, but, you know, it's already been a movie. Like, you know, I don't know. It's like when
Hollywood really, Hollywood really loves just remaking everything, just everything they can. And like you said, there's so many. And actually, that's one thing you were mentioning this summer. That's one thing that I really like about this summer. There's a lot of newer original things. There's not too many remakes. There's not sequels. There's a couple sequels out there. The Meg 2, right. for instance, a fantastic sequel. but it's been a lot of original stuff.
Yeah. No, I agree. Oppenheimer was, I mean, it's such a great story too. And the whole thing was like, he did this thing to beat the Germans in building the bomb. He was conflicted about it, but he's like, what else can I do? I know it's better in our hands than theirs. So you kind of sympathize with him. And then they tore him down later in his life for doing that, for proliferating or, you know, and it's like, well, what's this guy supposed to do? Like, you approached him, you asked him to do this. At the time, it was the right decision. But I love that there's that whole controversy about that. So I really like that movie.
Even if it's something that I'm not super keen on, if it's original, I will at least give it props for that. Asteroid City came out earlier this summer. I love Wes Anderson, but that just didn't really do it for me. But it was a very... I hadn't seen a movie like Asteroid City before. How about that? It was very much its own thing, and I liked what they were going for with it. And I have to give it props for that sort of thing.
Wes Anderson's the guy to do that, too. I loved Bottle Rocket. Okay, so I want to thank our guests today, Rob Thomas, Greg Glienna, Danielle Szmanda, and Mike Clemens. Great job, everybody. The three movies, go check them out. Parallax View, The Diplomat, and drumroll, Aaron Brockovich. Mike and Dom will be back Monday. Thanks for letting me sit in. I'm Pete Schwaba. Thank you to Nate. We're out. Thanks.